This is Mike Neal, Funky Ned. Came up with Rare Essence. As a matter of fact, I'm one of the four guys that actually started the band. Myself, Foots, White Boy, and Big Horn, John Jones. Foots came up with that name. There was a perfume called, I think it was Bear Essence or something like that. So he just changed it to Rare Essence, and there it was.
Rare Essence in the 70s, 80s, you guys were known as a groove band. How did y'all come up with that style?
Hanging out with Chuck. Funk used to take us up to the Maverick Room to watch Chuck Brown and the Soul Searchers rehearse. And we just sit in there and watch them. And basically go back home and try to do what they did. But Funk didn't really join the band till later. When we got hot, that's when he came on board and said. But no, he used to be upstairs giving us records to play. As a matter of fact, Funk had an ear, man. He still has it. He has an ear for picking hits, right? That's a gift. As a matter of fact, I can name three songs off the top of my head that I didn't want any parts of. The very first one I could think of, he came downstairs one day and said, "Hey, stop what y'all doing, learn this right here. This is gonna be a hit." And I said, "Man, I don't wanna learn this." And this thing, he put the record on and I listened. I said, "Man, this bull, man, this is the hottest thing out there." It was a song called Brick House by the Commodores. And this was before the radio started playing it. So then he pulled this other one out called Dance to the Drummer's Beat, which became a huge hit for us. And I can't remember the other one. I think it was Electric Slide or something like that. Which became a huge, we didn't play much in the go-go's, but at the cabarets we used to do, oh my God, we couldn't leave unless we played that song.
Rare Essence had a lot of hits, man. The two that still played today was a crowd favorite was One on One and Lock It.
Musically, most of One on One, percussion of course was Foots and Jungle Boogie. Foots, Jungle Boogie, and David, something about the three of them, the way they locked. David plays cowbell. I'm in DC, God rest his soul, was one heck of a cowbell player. But David just took it to a whole nother level. Now the percussion and stuff, that was Foots, Jungle Boogie, David, DC. But the music was mostly Godfather. We hardly ever played songs, it was just groove. Each night was something different. We never played it the same way twice. I challenge you to find a tape where we playing the same song the same way twice. If you do, I'll give you a dollar. But what it was whoever was on the mic, usually Funk or Benny, and they just feed off the crowd. And we just kind of drive the car based on what the crowd is telling us to do. You read the crowd and you react. But I think that's go-go. You read the crowd and you just have a party with the people in front of you. That's what it is.
That groove and that chemistry y'all have, did it come natural?
When you playing 4, 5, 6 nights a week that often with the same people over and over, you just kind of, it's like basketball players. You just know what everybody's going to do. I know what Foots is going to do 90% of the time. When he does something different, that's when we get excited. Oh, okay. But when you play the same thing over and over, you just start to look for little ways to kind of make it a little different. And that's how stuff just kind of build over the years, kind of morph. Or evolve into something.
Now go-go is a lot more structured. You have set lists and arrangements. Back in the 70s, 80s, no such thing as a set list or anything like that unless you were on a big national show, but just the regular club nights, it was feel.
That's exactly what I was telling you a minute ago. Whatever we getting from the crowd, we just do it. Sometimes Godfather would just start playing chords, and if Funk or Benny is with it, they're like, "Yeah, come on, Godfather." If they're not, you hear, "Mingay!" In other words, cut that noise.
You had to have a nickname in go-go, and your nickname was Funky Ned.
There was this TV show on called Good Times. There was a dude Ned the Wino. Because my eyes used to be red all the time from allergies. So anyway, by the time we started the band, we were playing down Hart Junior High School. I remember that. And we were doing something. And little Benny said, "Come on, Funky Ned!" And it stuck.
So Benny gave you that name.
Benny gave me that name. Hey, look, Benny gave White Boy his name, too. I've heard White Boy's version of the story about the girls thought he was light-skinned, so they was like, no, let me set the record straight. He probably going to call me and say, "Come on, man." Every summer, when the band first started, White Boy would leave us every summer and go, I think, down to his grandma's house or something down in Mississippi or wherever. And this would happen like 3, 4 summers in a row. Now, right when we started getting popular, We was playing at the Metro Club, and he would roll out. So we have all summer without, you know, without him. One summer, you know, he's up there, Maverick Room doing our thing, playing Mr. Magic. But this night, that boy came back, and I knew something should have been up because he had these little pedals on the floor. So we playing Mr. Magic, grooving like I don't know what. And then, you know, time for white, you know, Andre taking solo. We came around, and all of a sudden, dude went. I'm like, what? Little Benny got on the mic and said, come on, white boy! And it stuck. Then a bass player and a drummer locking, it's a beautiful thing, man. It is a beautiful thing. You couldn't help but lock with Foots, because he's real solid. You just get in his pocket and just stay there, because he's not going to move. If he does move, I just kind of look back at him and say, you all right? And if I know, Fonz going to say, come on! You know, when he steps back and starts doing this, we know something's wrong with the tempo. It's all right, let's fix it.
And how was it playing with Foots, rest in peace, man? He was such a solid drummer.
Let me tell you something. Foots was so tight, he actually he fell asleep a couple nights playing. We didn't notice he was asleep until his tempo started slowing down. It's like, what? Listening to those old tapes, the first thing that jumps out at you is the percussion. You just get in that pocket with them and stay there. Most people don't even understand the word pocket. That's when everything is locking, when everything is smooth, the tempo's not fluctuating all over the place. And I say this about Foots. Last year when I was trying to find a drummer to play his stuff, because we would record some of that old school, the thing about Foots, I think, was that the way he played, he wanted to be out there on the floor dancing. And it came through in his playing. He said, I'm going to dance one way or the other. And that's what it feels like. You could dance through the way he plays. And I don't think drummers do that. They're so busy trying to play a go-go beat. Oh, man, just sit down and dance with the sticks. Foots left, man. When he left us, well, we were struggling for a minute there. We were struggling.
Who was the first band to back it up?
If I remember correctly, it was at the K-Wood Theater. And we did something, and we messed up. It was a mistake. It was so hot, the people was like, do it again. Are you serious? Y'all want us to do that again? Now, as I look up, nowadays, I can't remember what I did 2 minutes ago. But back then, it's like, yeah, let's do it again. So we figured out a way to do it again and did it again.
But
it became a thing. Because of what was happening and the way we were doing it, it just made sense to fill that space with that type of thing, right? Because if we're going to crescendo to a drop and there's going to be a drum roll, it makes sense musically to have something build up to that.
That was the time for the percussion. Oh, to get their just due too.
That's it, because that build up and then the drop, people waiting for it. There are several bass players I just kind of took my style from. Number one being Larry Graham, Stanley Clark, Chris Squire, Verdine White. Verdine had that real tight funk. You listen to Earth, Wind & Fire, that bass is right where it's supposed to be. No more, no less. I've been trying to teach bass players, man, less is more, gentlemen. Stop trying to fill up all that space. Leave that space, man. Let the congas and the guitar and the keyboards and the percussion, let them fill that space. You just give me a boop. You ain't gotta go put your hands in your pocket, man. Give me one note, maybe two, and then put your hands in your pocket.
Everybody wanted to play like Ray Asses.
The beauty of go-go. I mean, just like bands were trying to be like us, we were trying to be like Chuck. But you do what you can, and then you just kind of take it and do your own thing with it, right? That's what I love about Junkyard. Backyard, Northeast Groovers, oh my God. There's gonna be some copying. That just goes without saying. But to take it and then go your way with it, that's what makes it beautiful. Because now you've got this smorgasbord of different go-go bands. And people know what they like and they gravitate towards that. But that was the beauty of it. Somebody who's not from here, all of it sounds the same. A trained ear that knows what's going on, you can tell right away what's backyard. Was as we became more and more popular, it was Chuck, and he was calling us Baby Soul Searchers. that's how much we were like them. We was trying to be them, but I mean, we had a bit more energy and we just wanted to take what they had and just run with it. But like, nah, slow that down. Nah, we gonna run. If you listen to the old tapes, man, I don't know if it's the broken cassette player going too fast, but we are speedballing, but it's funky. When you went to see Rascals, it was constant motion. Something was always, because I look at bands nowadays, and everybody's just standing around, and it drives me. I'm like, oh my God, how are you guys getting away with this? Really? People that went to the Coliseum, when you had all those go-go bands, it was a good show because you knew these guys would be trying to outdo each other. We actually got a chance to put on a show because we would work towards doing more than we normally do in the club, which makes sense. Well, I'm going to pay $10, but this night I'm going to pay $25. Y'all not going to do the same thing, are you? Of course not, man. When I leave that stage, blood, sweat, and tears are going to be out there on that stage because I'm going to leave everything I got on that stage, which is what you should do as a musician.
How long did you play with Red Assles before you moved on?
I left in 98, because by then I'd been touring for several years, and it seemed like every time I came home it was just one thing after another. We was out of Gum Springs, I think it was, either Gum Springs or Dale City, some skating rink. And I showed up, and my mom, who worked with the band, Go-Go Marge, by the way, y'all, was at the door talking to Miss Jackson, Kevin Jackson's mom. You know Kevin Jackson?
Mm-hmm.
Proper, what's the name of that group? Hot Property?
Prophecy.
Prophecy, yeah. And I was there talking, I said, yeah, this is Miss Jackson's. I was talking to her for a second. And I was standing up, and all of a sudden I say, who's playing bass? Because whoever was playing bass was playing bass. I said, that's how you play bass, whoever that is. And I said, and she says, oh, that's Little Michelle. I said, that's a girl? I grabbed my guitar, my bat. I said, I'll see you later. I have to see this. I was like, that's a bass player. And the girl, because everybody thinks I taught her how to play. I was like, nah, youngin. She may have had some influence, but that girl could play when I met her, because that's the night I met her. She was playing that thing. I said, come on, bass players don't play like this. This is bass playing. Michelle Ndege Ocello, yes.
Yeah, he had some of the funkiest bass lines.
That's the thing about Michelle. Her shows were kind of like, they weren't go-go's because she's playing her music, which I don't even know what to call it. But, and we played the same songs every night, but we never played them the same way. I mean, we playing the same thing. Sometimes we play slow, sometimes we play fast. Whatever mood she was in, that's how we played, right? Whatever mood she was in. That's how the night went. I mean, it was always different, man. It was always, I think there's something on YouTube when we did the North Sea Jazz Festival. That was a crazy show for me because I just did not feel like playing. I was in a foul mood. And we came on and we was doing that do-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da- side of the stage was Larry Graham and Bootsy Collins standing right next to each other, standing there grooving, and I just say, yes, if they're feeling this, how come I'm not feeling it? And I just opened up, man, and was able to just relax and play. We were somewhere rehearsing in LA once, and it was some song that she had. I just couldn't get this riff in the middle, and whatever, just wasn't coming together for me. And she got mad, and it got to the point where she's like, come on, it's you! I got it from you! I was like, Shorty, I don't remember ever playing like she said, I got that from you, that's you, just be you. I was like, okay. Let me tell you something. Her music, night after night, was just fun. The first recording I did with Maxwell was this song called Dance With Me, I think that's the name of it.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And it was just me and a friend of mine went to New York. I got to the session early, like I always do. He was upset because I wasn't alone. He had me come in his room. It was him and the engineer. And he took out my bass, plugged it in, played it. Tuned up, took me about 2 minutes. I said, what you want? Right? And he pushed play on the side. I need you to play this bass line. I played it, right? So the next time that I was working with Maxwell, I came up on a Saturday again to New York. And I went through the studio, different studio, but I went there. And it's like, there's no session today. We have Maxwell, but not till Tuesday. I'm like, really? called his management. Nobody answered the phone, called around. No big deal. Go get back on the train, go back home. But somebody's paying me for my time, right? No problem there. So on my way out the door, Federico walks in. You know Federico, keyboard player.
Federico awesome, Pena.
Unbelievable keyboard player. Federico Gonzalez Pena, right? He walked in. I said, hey man, there's no session days. Yeah, yes it is. They told me to come. I said, they told you to come here too? Yeah, so I know it wasn't me. So we're in the wrong place. There's a session, but not till Tuesday. So he got to thinking. So we ended up going to this other studio. He said, well, try this mic before we go home. I said, all right, whatever. We went to a place called Electric Lady, where, what's his name? Jimi Hendrix did all this stuff. And we walk into the big A room, and there's Maxwell standing at the board. Now, this dude don't really know me, right? But he starts to fuss and cuss at me for being late, right? Anybody that knows me knows Mike Neal is never late. Anyway, so before I could open my mouth and respond to this dude, Fred pushes me out of the way and tears Maxwell a new one. He said, you motherfucker, this guy, this dude is never late. If he went to the wrong place, it's because you messed up, right? Such as that, I went there too, and it was just a big mess. It was a big mess. So here we are, supposed to be recording or whatever, but the vibe is all jacked up now. He's trying to calm, get everything calmed back down, and so we get to talking, right? It's like maybe a half hour, hour later. I'm sitting in the back of some of the room with Maxwell, right? He's like, yo, buddy, the first time I met you, man, I was so nervous. I'm like, nervous? Nervous to meet me for it? Like, yo, buddy. When that first song you played on, man, we went through like 30 bass players, man, trying to get that thing right. And I was sitting there with Wawa Watson, you know. And you people who don't know who Wawa Watson is, just go grab your mommies and daddies' albums. And anybody that has an afro on the album cover, he's probably on that record, right? That's who Wawa Watson is. So he said, yeah, man, we were sitting there and Wawa was like, hey man, there's this kid down in D.C. Right, calling that kid, right? Now the way I know Wawa is that when we were playing with Michelle, whenever we played in Los Angeles, he would come and sit in with us because he lives in L.A. And I never said two words to Wawa, so I don't really know him, but I guess from them just watching me and know how I am, just how I handled that band, he said, yo. This is Maxwell telling me the story. He said, yo, hey Maxwell, there's this kid down in D.C. You call him and tell him, you know, just bring him up here, man. He'll knock this thing out for you. He said, but Maxwell, listen, this ain't like them other bass players you be dealing with, right? I said, what are you talking about? Maxwell said, man, we call dudes to come in to do recordings all the time. We have a session at 1 o'clock. They show up at 4 or 5, come 2-3 hours late to a session. Then they come in and they plug in their guitar and they learn it, play every technique they ever learned in their life and all this other stuff. Wawa said, Maxwell, he ain't like everybody else. He said, you bring this guy up here, tell him what you want, and then get the F out of his way. I just started laughing. He said, Shomani, when you showed up, first you came early. Nobody comes early to sessions in New York. He said, then you pulled your guitar out the case. He said, you plugged your guitar in and you tuned up, took you like a minute, and you looked up and said, what you want? He said, man, that freaked me out. I've never seen anything like that before. And I remember, because he had this weird look on his face when I did that. He was standing at the 24-track machine. He said, I need you to play this bass line. And he pushed play on the tape machine and walked out. A half hour later, I was finished. Finished talking with him. So I go back out here and I sit with the engineer at the board. I said, so hey man, just hit record. And he hit record. And that tape, that one take I did, is what you hear on Something Something. When you listen to Something Something, that's the take from that crazy day with Maxwell and Fred almost throwing him out of a window. One of the things that happened that actually did something to me was when we did that video with Aretha Franklin. Now, I don't know if anybody remembers, Rare Essence did an album called Live at Breezes, right?
Yeah.
Live at Breezes. That morning, we got a phone call from Ms. Mack saying, hey, he said, bring a suitcase because we're going to leave after the recording, get on a bus, and go to Detroit to shoot a video with Aretha Franklin. I think I had to go back home again because I didn't believe her, right? Yeah. Aretha Franklin, yeah, right. Sure, you're right. But that's exactly what happened. When we finished cutting that album, we got on the bus that was waiting outside and drove to Detroit. I think it was 10 straight hours. Man, we got up there, and by before the bus left, Miss Mack and my mom had brought all our uniforms. Now, if you remember Essence back in the day, I think we had 3 or 4 different tuxedos. We had white tuxedos, we had tan tuxedos, and some other color, I can't remember. We had white leather, red leather, white satin, red satin. I mean, we had all this crazy funkadelic looking stuff. I don't think we brought the Super Chicken outfits. We did a show at the Capitol Center one night, man. These tight, crazy looking pants. I think Donnell called it Super Chickens, man. It was so funny. Looked like chickens. But we get up there, right? We're working with the director. He's telling us, you know, what he wants. So we on this huge stage. If you ever see the video, there's this huge stage, and the band is spread all out, right? And I remember the director standing there and says, roll the music, and we, you know, jamming around, doing whatever. And he says, cut. And he says, calls all his understudies. He says, hey, go to, what's the place? Kmart, local Kmart, bro, and get a bunch of sweatshirts. Right, so they run, they come back, and he comes back, and everybody puts on a sweatshirt, except me. I'm the only one in the video that's actually wearing their own clothes. And roll the tape, and we start jamming, jumping. Cut. Go get me some scissors. So everybody runs off, come back with all these scissors. Hey, everybody, come on down front. All the guys take off their sweatshirt. He takes them, they start ripping them and cutting them and making them look all, and you look, see the video, you see all this crazy. And he said, all right, put them back on, get back on stage. Roll the music. We don't care. We just doing our thing. We in a video with Aretha Franklin. So here comes Aretha. Now it's time to shoot with her. She walked in and looked at us like we were some dog doodle from up under the earth. When the director came out to our bus and we showed him our outfits that we can wear in the video, he looked at that and said, oh no, you cannot wear this. You can't wear any of this. I was like, why not? And simply, he said, because if you wear this, you will upstage Aretha, and I cannot have that. But she looked at us, man, like, and next thing you know, those two are going back and forth, her and the director. She don't want to do it. She don't be bothered. There's like 200 people there, people that called the radio station and won a chance to be in a video with Aretha, right? So here they are. So lunchtime comes. All these people are standing in line to get her autograph. Well, guess who else was in that line? Everybody got their plates. Nobody's got food on them because everybody's getting her signature, right? Well, we got there and they gave her the thing to sign, and she looked up and saw that it was us, flipped the thing back across the table, said, put your address on it and I'm gonna mail it to you. What? In one motion, the whole band was like, F this. It's like somebody took a dagger and just stuck it right into your heart. But I knew this, and I'm gonna go to my grave with this. I said, I will never make one of my fans feel like she made me feel that day. I will never. I don't care what I'm doing. If somebody come up and say, hey, fuck, I'm going to stop what I'm doing and acknowledge you and talk to you for a minute or whatever, and just say, hey, man, thank you so much for whatever. And I'm glad you enjoyed the music, whatever. So that awful experience changed my life in a positive way. I said, I'm going to take this negative and turn it into a positive.
Any advice or anything you want to say to the go-go community?
To the go-go community, I would simply say this. Now that go-go music is the official music of Washington, D.C. Brothers, sisters, get your acts together. There's grant money to be had. There's monies in the arts department with D.C., I know there's not a lot of shows right now because of the pandemic, but this too shall pass. Just hang in there. Washington, D.C. is the capital of the United States of America. Music that was born and bred here in this city is the official music of Washington, D.C. It was signed into law. It's law now. So embrace the music. Get your chops up. Write good songs. Record them. Let as many people as you can hear them. And let's see where this goes. You get an opportunity to represent playing this style of music. Go for it. I mean, go for it. Because a lot of people don't understand how it all came together. Maybe you won't be able to explain how some of those African rhythms are being played against this type of... Don't worry about all that. Just play it. Have fun. And make sure the people that are watching you can see you having fun. Because it is a fun style of music. It is. Enjoy it. Let everybody hear it.
Mike Neal in the building, Funky Ned, y'all. Yes, sir.